Goldfinger. He's the man with the Midas touch.
Midas, in a version by Ted Hughes. Peasants crowded to gulp at the Silenus, the end product of a life they could not imagine. They chained him with flowers and dragged him in a harness of flowers to their king, Midas, as if he were some harmless, helpless, half-tapir or other charming monster. When Midas recognised him and honoured him, fat and old and drunk as he was, as the companion of Bacchus, and restored him to the god, Bacchus was so grateful he offered to grant Midas any wish. Whatever the king wanted, it would be granted. Midas was overjoyed to hear this first approach so promising of his peculiar, horrible doom. He did not have to rack his brains. A certain fantasy hovered in his head perpetually, wistfully, fondled all his thoughts by day, manipulated all his dreams by night. Now it saw its chance and seized his tongue. It shoved aside the billion infinite opportunities for Midas to secure a happiness guaranteed within the human range of what is possible to a god. It grasped with a king's inane greed the fate I shall describe. Midas said, "Here is my wish. Let whatever I touch become gold. Yes, gold. The finest, the purest, the brightest." Bacchus gazed at the king and sighed gently. He felt pity, yet his curiosity was intrigued to see how such stupidity would be punished, so he granted the wish, then stood back to watch. The Phrygian king returned through the garden, eager to test the power, yet apprehensive that he had merely dreamed and now was awake, where alchemy never works. He broke a twig from a low branch of oak. The leaves turned to heavy gold as he stared at them, and his mouth went dry. He felt his brain move strangely like a muscle. He picked up a stone and weighed it in his hand as it doubled its weight, then doubled it again and became bright yellow. He brushed his hand over a clump of grass, and the blade stayed bent, soft ribbons of gold foil. A ripe ear of corn was crisp and dry and light as he plucked it, but a heavy slug of gold, intricately braided, as he rolled it between his palms. It was then that a cold thought seemed to whisper. He had wanted to chew the milky grains, but none broke chaffily free from their pockets. The ear was gold, its grain inedible, inaccessibly solid with a core. He frowned. With a frown on his face, he reached for a hanging apple. With a slight twist, he took the sudden weight, no longer so happily. This was a fruit he made no attempt to bite as he pondered its colour. Almost inadvertently, he stroked the door pillars as he entered the palace, pausing to watch the brilliant yellow suffuse the dark stone. He washed his hands under flowing water at a fountain. Already a hope told him that the gift might wash away, as waking up will wash out a nightmare. But the water that touched him coiled into the pool below as plumes of golden smoke, settling heavily in a silt of gold atoms. Suddenly his vision of transmuting his whole kingdom to gold made him sweat. It chilled him as he sat at the table and reached for a roasted bird. The carcass toppled from his horrified fingers into his dish with a clunk as if he'd picked up a table ornament. He reached for bread but could not break the plaque of gold that resembled a solid puddle smelted from ore. Almost in terror now, he reached for the goblet of wine. Taking his time, he poured in water, swirled the mix in what had been translucent rhinoceros horn, and set his lips to the cold rim. And others, dumbfounded by what they had already seen, were aghast when they saw the wet gold shine on his lips. And as he lowered the cup, saw him mouthing gold, spitting gold mush that had solidified like gold cinders. He got up reeling from his golden chair as if poisoned. He fell on his bed, face down, eyes closed from the golden heavy fold of his pillow. He prayed to the god who had given him the gift to take it back. I have been a fool. Forgive me, Bacchus. Forgive the greed that made me so stupid. Forgive me for a dream that had not touched the world where gold is truly gold and nothing but. Save me from my own shallowness, where I shall drown in gold and be buried in gold. Nothing can live, I see, in a world of gold. Bacchus, too, had had enough. His kindliness came uppermost easily. I return you, said the god, to your happier human limitations. But now you must wash away the last stain of the curse you begged for and prefer to every blessing. A river goes by Sardis. Follow it upstream. Find the source, which gushes from a cliff and plunges into a rocky pool. Plunge with it, though go completely under. Let that river carry your folly away and leave you clean. Midas obeyed, and the river's innocent water took whatever was left of the granted wish. Even today the soil of its floodplain can be combed into a sparse glitter, and big popcorns of gold in its gravels fever the fussicker. Midas never got over the shock. The sight of gold was like the thought of a bee to one just badly stung. It made his hair prickle, his nerves tingle. He retired to the mountain woods and a life of deliberate poverty. There he worshipped Pan, who lives in the mountain caves. King Midas was chastened, but not really changed. He was no wiser. His stupidity was merely lying low, waiting, as usual, for another chance to ruin his life. But then, that's another story.